Truth Frequency Radio Network. KTFRN. Worldwide.
Welcome, Shadowland Voyagers. In the spirit of sovereignty and self-empowerment, we invite you to journey with us into the Shadowland. Let's rediscover, reclaim, and integrate the fragmented aspects of our individual and collectively held consciousness. Realize true freedom and restore authentic expression. Could it be the only way out is through the Shadowland?
Welcome, Shadowland Voyagers. This is Sienna Leia, and I'm here with my co-host, Christina Grant. Good evening, Christina.
Good evening, everyone.
And the beautiful Elizabeth Hansen. Good evening, Elizabeth.
Good evening, everyone.
Tonight is episode 24, and we are really excited. We have somebody we have deep respect for, who has an understanding that is so profound that we are honored to have him. He's all the way from Australia. His name is Steve Richards. He's the creator of Holographic Kinetics, an advanced ancient Aboriginal healing technique. Holographic Kinetics is a combination of over 40 years of researching by its founder, Steve Richards. Steve understands the power of the subtle bodies from a holistic approach in the creation and removal of internal created realities within their own separate dimensions of time, as well as the understanding and removal of other dimensional forces that can enter through drugs, alcohol, trauma, and certain medications, which his research has found is the main reason for most mental illness. Stemming from ancient Aboriginal healing, his work of dreamtime healing is about the acknowledgement of his ancestral past and the ability of true lore, universal knowledge, that was known and understood by the ancestors and the culture of the past. The Aboriginals had the ability to take the free-flowing energy and use it to visualize through the dream time into the manifestation of reality. They were more developed using the spiritual internal world of manifestation rather than the external analytic world. Never seeing the world through analytic eyes, they were aware of the earth as a living spirit. They worked in harmony with the spirit of the earth and with the spirits of all life forms. They were taught by the understanding of communication with the spirits of animals, trees, rocks, water, and that all other life forms are alive. That also includes our thoughts that can become thought forms and grow into life forms that then can manipulate the soul of man. The original Australian Aboriginals were the most advanced spiritual people on this planet. They had the awareness and no limitations within the manifestation of creation. They had the ability to be in two places at the same time. They had the ability to move through time. They were not limited to this physical dimension. They could, and some still can, draw illness out through the body. Some of the clever elders that still know the old ways have said, "We know what we can do, but we do not go to school. Therefore, we do not know the words to use for what we can see and do. We only know that we can do what we can do. And there is the seen and the unseen, and all things are alive." Steve Richards, our guest tonight, knows the words and brings this advanced Aboriginal healing to the world now. Welcome to the show, Steve.
Thank you. That was well said, the way you put that. I couldn't have done it better.
I'm honored to speak those words. They're so deeply touching that there are a people that ancient and that true, and that you're carrying this wisdom and bringing it to us with the remarkable work that you're doing. We'd like to start the interview with asking you a little bit about your journey, your life, your history, who you are, who your ancestors were, and how you came through to birth this holographic kinetics.
Fine. Well, I'd say the first thing is, as a little four-year-old, my mother sat me down and she looked at me and she said, "How did you know these things were happening?" Because I just told her events are going to take place, and she says, "No, it's not." I said, "Yes, it is." Anyway, a bit of a challenge there, and I kept coming up to her, maybe five, six times. At 11 o'clock, this is going to take place, and spot on 11 o'clock it took place. So she sat me down and said, "How did you know these things were happening?" And I looked at it, and I remember saying, "Well, doesn't everybody remember the past?" Because I remembered it all. I knew things. Today, I'm aware that under some of the mental health programs out there, they're giving electric shock treatment to four-year-old children and claiming that they're remembering things that don't exist. Well, the reality is children do remember the past. And what takes place is in the first 7 years, whatever's taking place on the time track of a being as a trauma will reproduce itself in the first 7 years and continue within its own dimension. So that was my spirit entering the vehicle back there as a little child. But let's take the vehicle. The vehicle of body I entered into, we go down the genetic line. My great-grandma was taken away by what was known as the Aboriginal Protection Agency at the age of eight. In other words, it was a stolen generation. She was found in horse shackles at 14, sold to a drover, and died at 15, giving birth to my grandmother. My grandma was brought up on a cattle station, very well educated by the church. She used to walk around with rosary beads in her hand, Jesus on the wall, Mary on the wall. Very well programmed, as the soul had been programmed through this religious connotation. What they used to do, it built the living daylights out of them for speaking their own language, and they'd program the soul. Now, what took place as I grew up, my grandmother, she was also, because she didn't have a mother, she was raised and taken under the wing by the maids, the servants, the butlers and the gardeners, and they taught her the old ways. As I grew up, she talked about the old ways, and as she spoke about the old ways, that would trigger more memories in me of the past. By the time I was 8 years old, I could physically make water go around my finger without touching it. By the time I was a teenager, I was doing mind magic, things that we've never taught before. One was just fascinated that this can't be happening. How can we do this? So I spent 40 years trying to understand what the universe really is, what it consists of. I understood a lot of the old ways of coming through, but I didn't understand what it is we were doing or how we were doing. So I spent 40 years researching, and the old Aboriginal culture was dreamtime healing. That's because they would sit around in the dreamtime around the campfire. They didn't speak. They would telepathically communicate with each other, communicate to the animals, the trees, and they were put out for, say, the spirit of the kangaroo to donate the vehicle. The next day it would donate its vehicle and there's your lunch, but the soul is in fight or flight. The vehicle itself, when the spirit donates it, it moves to a higher octave. It's moving up the scale constantly into different vehicles. So there's your lunch. Now, this is the old way of the dream time. Taking that as an understanding, I looked at the body and we created what was known as holographic kinetics. Holographic kinetics because what takes place is energy is free to enter and free to leave. It's free to flow in the universe. And it's only when we capture that energy, it becomes what's known as inverted electromagnetic energy flux. This energy comes from what was known as the father, being the sun, as the mother is the earth. She gives birth. The sun, from it, is electrons. It is captured by us and then cycles within a mathematical formula into us as a thought to a thought form. From the thought form, it becomes now intelligent because we've programmed it into whatever that thought was. It now evolves from a thought form into a life form. When it reaches a life form status, it has the right to survive like anything else in nature. It only knows what created it. Example, if it's anger, then it will set the person up to reproduce situations of anger so it can be fed and it can grow. You now become the host of your own creation. As this takes place, it is growing, it's evolving, it's learning about you and all your reactors. As it learns about you and your reactors, it goes to another level where eventually it can become an entity internally created by you, which now creates a compulsive disorder, the multiple, the schizophrenic, the bipolar, all these other labels that are put on people are these life forms that are evolving within you because everything in nature is alive. But the way it works is when we capture that energy, we capture it within ourselves and that becomes part of a fractal of a hologram. Now, if we take the fractal of a hologram, the whole thing is with a fractal of a hologram, it will reproduce itself for the hologram. So this fractal has reproduced itself through time. You are the hologram. There we have the prisoners in the prison system. I don't know, Your Honor, why I keep doing the same thing over and over, stuck in time. There's a whole range of things going on out there we are aware of today that has not been looked at all under our normal mental health systems. And we need to understand these areas because we're never going to make changes until we do, because everything in nature is alive. Man is a hologram of time. Kinetics is the movement of that energy, which can be captured, which can be harnessed, which can be directed within us.
Is there a way to work with this energy, the kinetic energy of the universe, but not capture it, but work more in harmony with it?
Sure. What I'm saying here is that it is free-flowing in the universe. Everything is alive. Everything is free to flow. Free to enter, free to leave, and free to flow. It's only when we capture it by a thought, and it's usually only negative thoughts we capture. We let go of all the positive things in life, but capture the negative thought. We hang on to it. Once we capture it internally, and there's actually a mathematical formula for the way this works, but once we capture it inside us, it actually becomes alive with the program that captured it. That's all it knows. So anytime you try and harness anything in this universe, you're going to actually capture that energy and program it. Look, I can go right back to some of the stuff, the Aztecs. I can go back to the pyramid stuff. I can go back to Stonehenge. I can go back and look at so many things around the world that I'm aware of what they did and how they captured energy. I can see how they used to capture spirits into inanimate objects. All you've got to do first is start to understand just how the universe works and the laws within this universe and how laws, when they're violated, has consequences. So anytime you capture anything that is free in this universe, you no longer allow it to be free. So your question there is, can you harness it and utilize it for good? Everything is free. My thing is, why do you want to harness energy in the first place?
Mm-hmm. So we have our own energy that's generated within our body. I understand the heart is the seat of the soul. So is that your understanding? Is that where the energy originates from within our body, and okay, we use that energy then?
Well, let's go one step further, okay? And that is, first off, is that the soul of the vehicle is the physical vehicle and the experiences of the vehicle. Before you're even born, your vehicle has all, through the hologram of time, the ancestors within it. That vehicle in front of you that's just been born has all the memories of all the ancestors through time. Like, we're dealing with stolen generation trauma. And here's an example. We'll go to the person they can't associate with the children. So we go to find out where it comes from, and the spirit indicates it's linked to the great-great-great-grandmother. So then what we do through the hologram of time, we command the spirit of the great-great-grandmother, come forward now. Next minute, she's physically talking out of the body of the person on the table, as we've just accessed the hologram of time of the fractal of that dimension. Now, we deal with the trauma, and what she's saying on the table there is the trauma with her was they've just come and taken my children. I cannot afford to love any more of my children because I don't know when they can come and take the rest. So she shut down. This now passed through the soul, through the genetic line, through the ancestors. Today, they cannot associate the children. We then loop time upon the dimension, send it back in time to its creation, loop time, and once time loops itself, it creates a new time track outside time, and it changes that dimension. The moment we do that, this person then went on working with youth and down the track became Australian of the Year. These are some of the areas that we get into. Now, that's the soul of the vehicle. Now, the spirit. The spirit, before it even comes, it's chosen the parents it needs for the lessons it needs to learn. It enters and the spark of life at the moment of conception. The moment of conception. That spark is the spark of the heart. We have people that have heart transplants. And I say, do you know who owns your heart? No. You mind if I call through whoever owned your heart? And they're okay. I call through the person who owns the heart. And the next minute I'll have them crying their eyes out of the person on the table. I'll say, why are you crying? Because I'm leaving my family and children behind. Thank you. What happened? We find the trauma of why they lost their heart in the accident. We unfold time and space on the dimensions. We change the past and present for the future cycles of time. Then we go into the person who had the heart transplant. We bring them through to what happened to their heart. We change that for the future cycle. So in the future cycle, they both keep their hearts, because when they put another spirit, another heart in, it has a spirit connected to it. So you get a change of personalities.
Yes, I've heard examples of that.
I have too. So the energetic field of the body, where is that generated?
All right, the body itself is, we are harnessing by our thoughts energy around us all the time. Now, the thing is, you know, what are we going to do with that energy that's around us? Are we going to harness and just let go of it? You take a positive experience. You have a positive experience, you experience that moment of time and you let go of it. That energy is free to leave, free to move, free to flow. You haven't captured it. It's only the negative things that man seems to capture and hang on to. Now, once you hang on to it, your spirit says to give you what you want. So your spirit says, just say we'll use the anger bit. All right. I look at the spirit at times and say, it's a bit like the waiter in the restaurant. When you go in the restaurant in the morning, you get a menu and you might order, just say you order, you know, scrambled eggs as example. So the waiter goes and he delivers you the scrambled eggs. In the morning, your spirit gets up and says, what's on the screen? And it's got anger, bitterness. It says, all right, that's what you want. That's what I'll deliver. Because you've never changed the menu.
So if you're capturing energy with negative thoughts, that's what gets you stuck in time.
That's correct.
And if you're in what we call the now moment, the eternal now, and you're just flowing with life, then you stay out of time?
Okay, let's look at it again. Very similar, but I'll just enlighten you a little bit more on it. Mm-hmm. If you take the left side of the body, the left side of the body is actually the spirit. The right side is the soul. The left side is the internal world. The right side is the external world. The inside being the spirit, it is the feminine side. It is the artistic side. It is the creative side, where at times you get some people they classify as attention deficit disorder and other labels. And some of these people, they become very gifted people because their spirit is expressing through them. Now we take the opposite side as the soul. It's the programs. It is the memories that are programmed. And, of course, the external analytical world now is all the programs that we've taken on by ourselves. So as we have free-flowing energy in this universe and we capture that energy, we're not letting that energy that was free to move and free to flow, we're not abiding by law. We're capturing something in this universe and we're trying to harness it by that thought process. Now, once we've harnessed it, we've trapped it. Now, once we've trapped it, it reproduces itself for its own survival, and you actually become the host. It's like I saw a great documentary down the Amazon, and I saw this little fish, and the little fish, he gets a parasite in him, and the parasite makes the fish swim up to the surface and splash around on the surface in front of the birds, so it virtually commits suicide. The birds come down and snap it up and eat it. When they eat it, the parasite breaks out in the stomach of the bird, and then it spreads through the bird's droppings. This is how this little parasite gets the little fish to commit suicide and how it survives by manipulating the vessel of another. Well, this is what some of these life forms are doing at times.
So when you are working on someone, does the effect go through time with everyone connected to the being that is being cleared?
Well, it depends what we're talking about here now. Remember one thing. Every single thing created is created within its own dimension of time. Now, Time can be for 1 second. It can be for 1 minute. It can be for an hour. It can be for a week. It can be a month. It can be a year. It can be 10 years, 100 years, 1,000 years. I've had 17 people go back over a million years to events that happened on this planet. And they were here in other bodies, totally traumatized by the event that took place on the planet over a million years ago, still online, because that dimension had never been cleared. So what happens is a dimension itself is alive, and if it's in your field and you're trapped to that dimension, it will reproduce itself through the cycles of time. In other words, its dimension is a torus field from its beginning to its end, but it hasn't completed its dimension. Now, lifetime after lifetime, it now becomes a hypertorus field, where you, through lifetime after lifetime, reset up the same cycle with the same trauma because it has never been dealt with. To take that to another level, when you take three steps, your past step you took was the last one you took, the one you're in now is your present, and the choice you make next is your future. Without three dimensions of time, you'd be frozen in time. Well, that's interesting. Therefore, you must have had three dimensions. Therefore, you must have had a past life, a present life, and a future life, which you did. Now let's go one step further. Deja vu. That is the big cycle of time where everything is continued through time in the past. This now is the past and the present with the variables that have been created. And in the new future cycle of time, which we're coming into, the past and the present sets up the future. So whatever variables we've changed in the present for the past, it will make changes for the new future cycle of time. It will better the new cycle of time. So what takes place there, as we have three dimensions of the big picture, the deja vu, the present, and the future. It is the same, as I said, the fractal of the hologram to the hologram is a reproduction of itself through time, but you're only a fractal of another hologram through time. So what takes place? You've got to look at the big picture. Who are we? We have multiple dimensions within us, millions of dimensions in us. Every thought, everything we've ever captured is alive within ourselves. We create the disease. We create the illness. Now, when we change the dimension, that dimension created by us, it is changing our dimension of reality. Other people that may have been influenced by that dimension of reality, they have created their own dimension of reality around that episode. This is about the individual changing their dimension of reality. The moment they change their dimension of reality, what happens is other people around them can start to make changes because they're influencing other people around them. Now with genetics as example, your children are a hologram of you because within them is a hologram of you. When you go back and you change something with the grandmother or the great-grandmother, what takes place then is morphogenic resonance takes place and it clears that dimension, affecting all the genetic line under it from that moment in time, all the generations.
So, for example, if say that there's a thought form that goes throughout the history of the genetic line, say it's cleared from my field, does that clear it from the field of the ancestors and currently family?
What it does, it clears down the line. In other words, if your spirit, and this, remember, the vehicle itself is the soul. It is the experiences locked in. See, when a person's on the table here, I've got a number of parts talking to me. I've got one, the ego talking to me. I've got two, I've got the soul talking to me. Three, I've got the spirit talking to me. There are life forms trying to justify their existence in the person. And then at times I have entities and other forces, again, trying to communicate out of the vehicle. You've got to know who's talking. So you get to know exactly who you're talking to on the table. So when we're clearing something on the genetic line, if the event that took place came through from the great-great-great-grandmother, then that was created in its own dimension back in time with the great-great-great-grandmother. That dimension's growing through time as a life form, but all the dimensions under that become part of the hypertorus field of that dimension. The moment we loop time on the dimension, change it at its juncture, it then, from the great-great-great-grandmother, will clear all the generations linking that particular trauma or event. You got how that works there?
Yeah.
Remember, it's always down the track. It's down the track. But if it's something up the track that's affecting you, then we can access it to make change. You see, one of the things we cannot do, we cannot violate law. In other words, I, you, no one else, we cannot invade the space of another. I cannot go to your great-great-grandmother and change things unless it's affecting you. I have no right to access her dimension.
Right.
Example of that. If I accessed her dimension and she had a massive entity in there, I enter its game. Now I can be hit because I've now entered the game of another. What happens is, and this is one of the laws of the universe, very interesting law, this one here, and that is he who enters the dimension of another is governed by the laws of that dimension. Now, I'll give an example here. I've been in the prison system for some of the most violent men in the prison system. So here's an example. The guards one day pushed their buttons. I said, give me the worst man you got and watch what I can do. They said, you're wrong. So they gave me this man who was full of violence. Even the guards were scared of this guy. He was so full of anger and violence. So what happens is I actually access his spirit because his spirit knows how, where, when, and why anything was ever created on the timeline through time. His spirit indicates the cause effect went back to 2 years old. I go there. His mother and father are alcoholics and drug addicts. He knew nothing but the alcohol, the drug, and the violence. He was born under that dimension. All he knew was the violence because that dimension, he was now in its game. My spirit told me, I then had his spirit unfold time and space in that dimension. We then cleared the dimension, changed the dimension, put him outside time. And the moment we finished, you couldn't believe how humble the man was with gratitude. He didn't want to be the way he was. He was stuck in a dimension of time, governed by the laws of that dimension that he had no choice over.
But does it go back to where that was a balancing out? So before that, he created something that put him in the situation that his spirit chose then for him to incarnate into those circumstances?
That's correct. We then go back in time to find out why he chose aggressive, drug addict, and alcoholic parents. The universe says, well, as you've created this dimension in the past, you must experience it. Only then will you understand your dimension. Only then can we have balance. Because right now, in a galaxy, we have whole star systems, we have galaxies, we have planets. They're all linked to balance. You are a universe of your own. You need to be in balance with the rest of the universe so we, as a planet itself, can be in balance with the rest of the universe. It's all about balance.
Now, this only refers then to if you've captured energy, correct? Because that's when you get stuck in time. So then it repeats itself and you swing back and forth until you understand. Once realize that, then it's released. And then that's when the balance is attained?
Well, the energy you've captured, and this is the thing. You know, you've got to stop and have a look. What is a little baby? Have a little baby when a little baby's born. That little baby, the first thing it's doing is it's looking around the room. Wow, it's taking everything. It's taking everything externally in. It's observing, it's learning, it's processing. These life forms are doing the same thing through you. They were free in the universe to flow. They're free to maybe be captured by a tree or be captured by something else in nature. The moment you capture those, you captured energy. Now that energy you've captured itself is taking on its programming. Just like the little baby's growing with all the programming in it. Remember, you've got to look at man as being a multidimensional being in a multidimensional world. And the moment you look at it for what it truly is, then you'll understand what really created it back in time was the choices you made in that moment of time. You see, while you swing between the pendulum, action, reaction, cause and effect, while you're reacting back and forth and you're swinging back and forth, you are stuck in time within a dimension. You cannot move forward in time until you come to the nodal point of point zero. For only at point zero can you then observe the game as an observer to the game. You don't react to the game, you observe the game for what is a game. Then at point zero, you can move forward in time. Till then, you become stuck in time.
So you were talking about entering another's game and being
That's correct.
Observer to the game. So obviously we interact with people all the time. We go to work, we go to functions, we're constantly entering other people's creations. So then is it possible to enter into that situation yet remain an observer to the game and not get stuck into it?
Yes, it is. And the thing is, what we need first is to be aware that we're actually a spirit on a journey in a vehicle. This is the vehicle we chose for the journey. Now, we go one step further. Just say if you're going from wherever you're living to New York, and your vehicle broke down, you take another vehicle. Well, if this vehicle breaks down, you can take another vehicle to finish your journey because you're on a journey as a spirit. The moment you realize you're a spirit, then you'll start to realize that you really are the essence of this being and you are a very powerful being as a spirit. But you see what took place is the moment you came into this vehicle, it had actually been genetically engineered way back in time into amnesia. you forgot who you were. So what happens now? They started to program the soul. The soul are the external experiences upon you. Everything external to internal becomes programming of your soul. The spirit is the internal to the external. The soul, the external to the internal. One of the things we really have to understand is that this universe itself has laws. We have LAWS and we have LORE. The LOREs is knowledge of this universe, but these laws in the universe cover every dimension. I don't care what dimension you're on. I don't care what being you are on what dimension. You're governed by the same laws that cover every dimension. And one of the things about these dimensions is that nothing can invade the space of another without permission. So what happens is these other dimensions, they've set up games of entrapment through time to get people to disempower their spirit and give power to these things outside themselves and to take over and manipulate. Now, people have been programmed all the time without being aware of the programs that are taking place of their soul. But the moment you get back into your spirit and be aware and you step back at the point zero of the observer of the game for what it truly is, everything out there is separate dimensions. Everybody's playing different roles in these dimensions, but everything creates their own dimension. You're entering somebody's game every time you enter in their space. And this, of course, takes it to other levels now of understanding a lot of what I call violence within our own communities that I'm seeing by understanding this on another level as well. Now, to understand that, one of the laws of law in this universe is that if you kill or destroy the vehicle of another without permission, then that spirit who no longer has a vehicle has a right to your vehicle. So he can now enter your vehicle. Now, once he enters your vehicle, he can live his trauma through you. Now, I'm going to give you some examples here of some of those. You know, I've got a woman who comes to me and she's had three spinal operations. She's riddled with pain. This is 30 years later, riddled with pain. The friend said, look, my friend's a psychic. They told me something happened 8 years ago. My comment is I'm not interested in what your friends say. I only want to know what your spirit says. Get on the table. Her spirit indicates the cause and effect was 18 years old. Go there. Next minute, she's screaming hysterically on the table. I forgot. I totally forgot. Thank you. What happened? I'd had on collision in a car when I was 18. Thank you. And what happened? The other woman died. Thank you. Now, the first thing here is, do I have a reciprocal exchange of energy? So I now check, and sure enough, I do. So I then command the spirits invade the body, surface now. And up comes this other woman. Oh, you should have heard the spirit. She was ropeable because this woman was careless and had killed her. So how did she die? Spinal injuries. So what happened is, you know, brought the spirit through and, oh, she just wanted the woman to suffer good and proper. So I unfolded time and space on the dimension so it can't happen in the future cycle. And the spirit agreed and I released the spirit. The moment I did that and the spirit left, so did all the spinal issues. They weren't hers in the first place. It's animal spirits you can take on too. I mean, like a little boy, every morning he gets up and he goes down, he touches certain trees and certain rocks on the property. Now in the afternoon he's doing it. He's in the car and he's sniffing the air and the parents say, look, there's something wrong here. So they take him to the doctor and the doctor says, something wrong here. He needs to see a psychiatrist. They take him to a psychiatrist. The psychiatrist says, look, he needs to be locked up, medicated so we can monitor him and find out what's going on. They said, no. We're taking him to Brisbane to see this other guy. They brought him to see me. I put him on the table. The little boy's spirit indicated the cause effect went back to 8 years old. Thank you. Go there. What's happening? I'm on the mountaintop with my dad. Thank you. What's happening? I'm doing a ritual. Thank you. What's happening? I'm calling in my spirit totem. Thank you. And what's your spirit totem? Spirit of the kangaroo. Thank you. Well, when's the kangaroo come out? He comes out morning and evenings. So I ask spirit, I have a spirit of the kangaroo in the body. He says, yes, thank you. Step aside. Spirit of kangaroo, surface now. Why'd you invade the body? Speaking out of his body instantly, he says, he called me in. Thank you. I sent him back, loop time, change time, release the spirit of kangaroo. Instantly, the compulsive disorder stopped.
Do you find that most of these like diseases and issues such as that are caused by entities, whether a physical being or a created, you know, a thought or just imbalances in general?
Well, what is an imbalance? An imbalance had to be a thought and an emotion that's drawn out. Therefore, that thought and emotion become trapped energy. Where is it? It's in yourself. What is it? It's become alive. Thank you. It's reproducing itself. Thank you. for its own survival.
So that's why they get worse over time instead of getting better.
Because it's growing.
Yeah.
It's growing inside you, and it wants the vehicle. It wants to take over. Look, the moment it goes from the thought to the thought form to the life form and then it reaches the entity status now got compulsive disorder. You've got no control. He's now learned all about you. He's learned about your reactors. He's learned what makes you tick, and he's taken over. And once he takes over, then, of course, you know, you've got no control. Now, our system today, I look at it and I think it's still in the dark ages what some things is doing, because some of the medications giving people, instead of dealing with the cause and effect, it's just dumbing and numbing the person. Well, what does that do? That means it slows your defences even more. That now means you're vulnerable to bigger and more powerful forces that can come through.
Absolutely, and you see what happens to these people on these medications. I mean,
that's why they get
completely taken over. Yeah, it's terrible because they don't treat this cause. Going back to, I guess, when it's first triggered or it's brought up in this life, but you're saying it goes back even further to who knows when.
That's it.
All the way back to the beginning.
Your spirit knows when. Yeah. Your spirit knows when. If I ask it, it could go back 10,000 years to an event, and it go to the juncture of where it took place. You're going to be there reliving it. I tell you nothing. You will be there at that moment in time of your own creation, and then we'll change looping time on the dimension and put you outside time.
Yeah, that's a thing I'd like to discuss too, because there's some people who... the point is, you're not doing it for the person. You're assisting the person to do it for themselves.
Oh, yeah. Look, we as I say to my students, we tell you nothing. We do absolutely nothing. You're the creator of your reality. I'm not here to change your reality. I'm here to assist you to look at your own reality so you can change your reality. I couldn't care less what you've done in your time track because it's not my stuff.
That's right. You can't do it for someone else.
Sorry if you take it on. I'm going to take on your stuff. No way.
Yeah.
You know?
You can't do it for someone else. They have to do it for themselves.
That's correct. That's correct. They created their reality only by looking at their creation can they change their creation. For they are the creator of this universe that I see in front of me. And it is a universe.
You know, not only that, you brought up a very interesting perspective just to back up a little bit with regard to the thoughts being energy. That is a profound perspective that you brought up there because looking at it in a proactive way, basically this setup, I mean, if what happens when, say, a thought comes through the mind function and we believe it, if it's not evaluated and just brought in as, oh, that's mine, we're actually capturing energy, which then can become a life form. So in a proactive way, it seems that the universal lore is asking us to take responsibility for the thoughts that go through the mind function of the vessel. And is that an accurate way to put that?
One of the laws of the universe is man is responsible for his thought, his word, his deed, and his action, and no man can escape the cycles of time. Whatever you've chosen for your experience must unfold back onto you. You know, you go back, you know, I come from a culture that was 60,000 years the Aboriginal has been around for. Now, in that period of time, I hear white society, I'm saying, oh, they're into revenge killing. No, they're not. They're doing you a favour. Because what they did was if you in one of the communities, you speared someone who killed them, then that family would all take a spear, you'd stand out, and they'd all throw a spear at you. You can dodge it all you want. By dealing with it now, it's dealt with. You're no longer stuck in time.
Right.
And if you deal with something that happened in the past, you're dealing with it now, so it also frees it up?
If in the present you change the past, you now create a new time track, as time will loop itself outside time, and you now create a new future for the next cycle of time we're coming into.
And that's zero point, correct? Or can you talk about zero point?
What happens is the moment it's completed, it does 360 degrees onto itself. 360 degrees now means completion. Now a new time track outside of that's created, which is now reproducing the way you want it for the future.
Is there a way to move through life without getting stuck in time?
Well, I mean, one of the things is, as a spirit, you chose to come down here in this molecular mortal world and take on a molecular mortal vehicle to experience a new molecular mortal experiences. So therefore, all the experiences you've chosen and the positions you're in to create these experiences. In the past, if you go back, when you first came down here, man was very barbaric. Man has evolved. His consciousness has evolved, as a being has evolved, as all the facets of him is evolving. But not all of me is evolving. You know, there's new ones coming in, there's old ones going out in the game. So what takes place is that as you evolve and your awareness, and it is the word awareness here, you're ready then when the conjunction takes place to be outside of time and not stuck in time. If you're not outside time, then you will be inside time and it'll be Groundhog Day and it'll start all over again until eventually you learn. The universe, it doesn't care. It says, look, you create your reality, whatever you want, but there are certain laws, and that is, I can't take you into the future dimensions if you're not ready for it.
So when time loops itself at this conjunction, and those that are stuck in time, are you saying it starts all over again, like way back, like Stone Age, all over again? Like you start from the beginning again?
It's nothing new under the sun. Everything in the major cycle of time has happened before. And everything will reproduce itself in the new cycle of time with the variables that have been changed through time. So if you don't get out of the game, yes, Groundhog Day, it all starts again until you learn.
And so when this conjunction takes place and those are outside of time, what does that look like?
Well, everything is constantly evolving. I look at it again as the fractal of the hologram. And I understand that. If I send you back to something that you've done in the past, that's created the issues you've got today. The moment you go back and you recognize what you did in the past, you acknowledge it, and you make the choices for the new future cycle of time, only then will time loop itself 360 degrees and put you outside time. The moment it puts you outside time, you a day or two later, you go to those people and say, what came up during the session? They don't even remember because it's not there anymore. When the loop up comes, the same thing will take place. People won't even remember. You'll be where you're meant to be in that moment of time. But there's always a future where we're moving constantly and we're evolving. Mm-hmm. But you can't take somebody from a lower level that's not ready for a higher level. It's like putting a ladder against the wall. When you get up the very top of the ladder, you're going to see a real big picture. You see further, you see the bigger picture. But if you're on the first rung of the ladder, you're limited to what you're going to see. But if you try to get up the ladder two legs at a time, then you're liable to slip down off the ladder. And when people do that, they try to move forward too fast forward, then they're ready. Then they have what I call mental breakdowns. They weren't ready for the dimensions they tried to enter.
So in order to be ready, would you say it's important then to listen to your spirit and allow that deeper part of you to guide you then through your experiences?
Definitely. Look, everything you ever want to know, your spirit can access. Your spirit has the ability to manifest realities. You can tell what you want and you put it out there, and all of a sudden it's going to manifest for you. You know, yeah. People are brought to you want, information comes to you want. And you know what people out there doing? Instead of acknowledging their spirit, they're thanking everything else outside of their reality. Well, if you was a little spirit and you're doing all the work for this person and they're thanking everybody else and not recognizing you, how would you feel?
Yeah, and you know what's amazing is when you start recognizing and working with your spirit, then life gets really, really magical.
That's true. That's
yeah. Correct. Yeah, it's because absolutely amazing. And how does that work, I mean, on a practical level? I mean,
I'll give you a couple of funny examples here. You know, and one of the things my mother said when I was younger, she said, never trust the government. She'd never trust the banks because the Depression, you know, they took all the bank books and they gave you 10% of your money. And she remembered all this and she said, and if you want anything in life, don't expect anybody to give you anything. You have to learn to manifest. I didn't understand what she meant. But as I grew up, I heard more Aboriginal people talking about how they can manifest things. And I still didn't quite understand the word of it, but I could make things happen. And I didn't understand the fact that this was manifesting. And one day, I guess this was the time that really made me stop and look at what we were doing. And constantly I'd put out, and people and information would come as I wanted it. And one day I'm renting a place on a lake, and I'm out there daydreaming. I'm thinking, gee, it'd be nice to go fishing. So I looked up and I said, I'd like a little chinny so I can go fishing, thanks. Went inside, carried on doing what I was doing. Next day the dog next door's bark, 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 bark. I come outside, and here's this tinny. It's got its nose sticking out of the water. It's going tap, tap, tap on the rocks. I reach down and pull it up, and here's a 10-foot aluminium dinghy covered in slime. It had been under the water for heaven knows how long. but it just happened to surface the day after I asked for it.
Yeah.
I looked at it, I looked up, I said, oh, thank you for that. Next time, could I have a 100-footer? Within a week, I want a 100-foot catch, one of the biggest catches in the Southern Hemisphere. I spent 3 months on it. I said, I like this. I like being on the water. I'd like a houseboat. So I put out. I come around looking for a houseboat, and I find this houseboat. I said, no, too much work. I let go of it. 3 months later, I started looking around again. I came across the same houseboat. Some guy had bought it, spent 20 grand on it. Couldn't get a job down here. Had a job waiting out in the mines. I said, I'll give you 20 grand for another 25 grand in 3 months' time. There's the keys. I lived on that for 13 years, and it was 40 foot, two-story, 18 foot wide, big as an apartment on the water. Manifested.
The key for me in the manifesting is it's like you put the intent out, you make it really clear, and then you have to completely let it go. Like you can't hold on to it at all. You have to just trust your spirit to make it happen if it's meant to happen.
And that's correct. The key to that too is when people focus on it, they actually put resistance to it.
Mm-hmm.
The spirit can't bring it through because you're focusing external energy onto it, therefore you put a block to it.
That's right.
The moment you let go of it, then it can come from the invisible into the visible. It doesn't go from the visible to the invisible. It goes from the invisible to the visible. And this is the same I say out there. People say, you know, oh, rubbish, invisible world doesn't exist. Well, my question to all those people is, hand me a thought. It can't because it's invisible. First the thought, then stop. Look around you. Look around you where you are right in this moment. Look at the buildings. Look at the bridges. Look at the cars. Look at the items in your home. Do you realize everything out there was only a thought at one time?
So in my life, I see how this works, where you send it out there, your spirit rearranges the universe, makes this happen. I mean, I've had amazing things happen in my life this way as well. But I would imagine it's possible to manifest an object instantaneously. Is it the resistance in believing that can actually happen that prevents it from happening?
Our program. The moment you're born, you are starting to get programmed. This is about suppressing your spirit and then programming your soul into someone else's beliefs and reality. When you grow up in school, you talk about things like, you know, I remember one day as a young 14-year-old, I was out the back and here's the moon, full moon, and over at the east of the moon, about 45 degrees, there's this massive, massive, huge ball of light bigger than the moon. And I watched it for 30 seconds. I read, said, quick, come and look at this. And I come out and I'm told, don't be stupid. These things don't exist. I went to school the next day and was told, don't be stupid. These things don't exist. So I'm in the chook house down the back. And I looked up and I said, I want the answer to all those things that don't exist. I didn't understand that day what I did, but I put out to the universe, which then supplied the answer to all those things that didn't exist. But the point is, the programming was, you see something, you know what you see. Others are telling you in their reality doesn't exist and they're projecting upon you something doesn't exist. So what happens is we as a child start to take on all these other beliefs and realities that aren't ours. We get programmed by beliefs and realities that aren't ours. And we really forget how to communicate to our spirit and let it express. So through time, what takes place? Through time, we bury the spirit within us and we allow the soul and all the cells in our hologram of time to manipulate us for its own agenda. Therefore, how can we manifest realities when we're allowing our programming, which is in our cells, to manipulate and run us?
So what's something a person can do to just start to get in touch with their spirit? Just some easy ways to just... They'll say, I don't know what it sounds like. How do I know the difference between...
Okay. Well, intuition. How many times you go to do something and this little intuition, which is spirit, says, don't go there. But the old ego takes over, sure enough. And then later on, oh, I shouldn't have done that. I should have listened, but you didn't. You know, your spirit's there and it's really understanding and asking the question, recognize it. It's like until you recognize something, it is not going to recognize you. The moment you recognize and acknowledge it, it will recognize and acknowledge you. And this is in everything in nature. All the experiences that you lock in, that you catch your energy, once you catch it in, you lock into your cells. That locked into your cells externally to internally has been captured by the thoughts, becomes part of your soul. Every cell in that body of yours is alive and trying to reproduce itself. So in other words, you're being manipulated. you're being manipulated by something else. Now, while you're being manipulated by something else, your spirit's sitting back there and it says, I cannot override you because you, as a consciousness, as an ego, have the rights to this molecular mortal vehicle that you're in. It can only assist you when you tell it what you want to assist. So meanwhile, you as an ego, conscious thoughts and feelings, are running the vehicle because you have the rights to your free will and choice. And a good example of this, a real good example, look, I have people come in from around the world. I'm now in 26 countries around the world. I've got 600 students trained, and we're in 26 countries. So I've got a woman flies in from France. No one can help her. She's on my table. She's only 22. Next minute, she physically metamorphs. And I mean physical metamorphosis. In other words, one minute I've got a 22-year-old woman on the table. Next minute, I've got an 87-year-old Chinese grandmother curled up speaking to me in Chinese. Now, the spirit sent the being back through time and space to the cause of the effect of the invasion of this force. Next minute, bang, she's sitting up. I'm a Roman Catholic. Reincarnation doesn't exist. Her belief system instantly overrode her spirit. How could it show her where it's coming from? How could it make changes if she's not going to look because she has a program?
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Do you understand?
I understand to a certain degree, and I can see why you train people. What, it's a week-long process? I mean,
That's just tipping.
You're just scratching the surface.
That's it.
Yeah.
There's so many areas we're getting to. I mean, we take what you said a moment ago before about the beliefs. Well, one of the things that takes place is we have the assumptions and beliefs. If you assume something to be, then that assumption and belief will override your spirit because it is your assumption and belief. And remember, in a physical, molecular, mortal world, you have the free will choice of this vehicle and all the games you wish to play. And spirit can't override you. You have to ask your spirit to take you to where you need to make changes, and you have to be prepared to listen to it. Again, I'll give another example of that. I got a woman who got screaming in the head. She had screaming in the head for 30-odd years, and she says, this man I used to go through, this thing's attached to him. It's yelling, screaming at me, attacking me. I said, won't you listen to me? I said, it's an assumption. No, it's not. It's happening. I said, can you listen to me again? I said, the effect is you got yelling and screaming in the head. But the belief is you assume it to be coming from him. That's an assumption. Put that aside. Because while you've got an assumption and a belief, you've got to lock that in and you're looking for the answer back there with him. That's not it. You've got to let your spirit show you where it came from. So once she got that into her head and allowed it to take place, we end up going back to the age of 9 years old. And her father and the other brothers are screaming and yelling at each other. She's petrified. That petrified created a thought form. The thought form evolved to a life form. The life form's evolved to an entity. 30 years later, still yelling and screaming at her in the head. The moment we went back to the dimension, looped time, changed the dimension, put her outside time, instantly the screaming and yelling stopped.
Yeah, see, that's the thing. The belief systems, you already are setting yourself up.
That's correct.
And expectations, assumptions, all of those things. You have to get rid of all of those things because then you're not in this neutral state. And that's the...
That's correct because what you're doing is with that belief is you're acting and you're reacting. You're in the pendulum.
There you go. And then you're back and forth.
That's correct. When we evolve in these, I'm giving an example here of a very unusual, one of the unusual, but I mean similar types I get. And I've got a woman comes to me and she's on medication because she's attempted suicide. Her sister's in a mental institution. She attempted suicide. The sister's on Prozac, attempted suicide. Mother's in a mental institution, attempted suicide. Two of the cousins have committed suicide. Mother's two cousins committed suicide. And two other cousins have attempted suicide. Now, there's 9 people in the family that have attempted suicide. Okay, get on the table. We're going to find the cause and effect of what we're dealing with. And her spirit indicates it's linked to the great-great-grandfather. Through a hologram of time, we have a command, the great-great-grandfather, come forward now. Next minute, he's speaking out of the body. What took place? I'm on a farm out west. Lonely, depressed. This isn't living. What's the use of living? His thought process of this, what's the use of living, locked in, create a thought form. One day he had a few beers. His defense were down And the life form now took over and walked him into the harvester and killed him. So then I call through the life form. Remember, it's intelligent, this life form. It's evolving. It's evolving a form of an entity and beyond. I called it through. The first thing it said when it came through was, he was easy to take out. Now I'm taking out the rest of the family. Because that's all it knew in its creation. Until we unfolded time and space on the juncture of that creation, looped time, changed the dimension, put him outside time. That then will affect and change the dimensions. You get that?
Is there a way for the average person to sense the difference between these entities and thought forms that become entities and what is their energy? What is the spirit? What is them? And what is the other thing? I mean, for people who...
Well, hang on, there's more than one. Yeah. There's more than one thing. You know, you've got first off, yes. You'd be surprised the amount of people that come to me, and they may have been seeing psychiatrists, psychologists, counsellors, because they know there's something in there and it's not them. Or they know they've got a voice in their head, it's not them. They know it's not them. Now, I mean, you know if it's you, and you know if it's not you. But I'm doing it and I have no control because there's something there manipulating me. They come. When they do, we go and find out what it is. Now, it could be another spirit that you've taken on. It could be an animal spirit that you've taken on. If you killed an animal in the past, you can have it in there and it can be living its trauma through you. It could have been a thought form has evolved to an internal entity and it's now manipulating you for its own agenda. It could be an external entity has come in because you've been on the drugs or the alcohol and you've opened something, a wormhole to their dimension. When you open the wormhole to the dimension, that's free will and choice to let them come in. And we deal with people all the time. We go back to find out where these things came from. So here's how subtle it is. We go back as a young child. I've got the wrong parents. I don't want to be here. That is an invitation for something that does. I wish I was dead. That's an invitation for something that wants to live. I wish I had a friend. Now the little friend appears and eventually takes over the child. Do you understand? The first is a law of intent in the invisible world. Once it's set into play, that's a valid agreement between you and the being. Then when we start speaking in the physical world, it comes in the physical world of reality. Then you've got the big boys, and they link to rituals for thousands of years. They link to a lot of the church stuff, a lot of the rituals, a lot of things, and they're pretty big and powerful, these fellas. Yeah, you know, look, I'm fully aware that a lot of the suicides out there are linked to other dimensions. The whole idea is if these beings can get you to terminate your vehicle, then they get the born rights to your vehicle in the next cycle of time. There's so much more going on in our world that our mainstream system has got absolutely no idea of. And yet Aboriginal culture and other native cultures around the world have been aware of all these dimensions for thousands of years. You know, there's still stuff these fellas can do, you know, that's really just magic. And I say, why don't you teach others? Speak about it. They look at me and say, why? They don't listen. They think they know it all. And that's what's happening out there today. They're not listening. They think they know it all, and they're trying to bring you into their reality of limitation. Whereas they stopped and listened to some of these cultures, they would learn a lot more about our world and how to have a more balanced world. They've gone too far off to the right.
Steve, we should take a short break now, and then we'll come right back for hour two.
No problems.
Of the U.S. Patriot Act and the NDAA.
This is the Truth Frequency Radio Network.
Welcome back, everyone. This is Shadowland Voyagers, and this is Sienna Leah. I'm here with Christina Grant and Elizabeth Hansen, and tonight's guest is Steve Richards. We're having an incredible conversation, getting questions answered from Steve that I haven't heard before. So I'm absolutely thrilled. And all right, where did we leave off this discussion? Big silence.
Crazy animals, Chinese women curled up on the table.
Actually, well, I am curious about the metamorphosizing. Sure. What is that word? How does that happen on a molecular level? Do you have any understanding on that?
Look, as I said, you're a fractal of a hologram. If something's changed in the fractal, then the whole hologram is going to be changing. And many occasions when we bring up some of the forces that are in human bodies, for a start, if you walk down the street, you will see in people's features at times other beings from other dimensions. When you start accessing and taking these beings out, you'll see the features physically change. I mean, I say to my students on my first day, out of the 7 days, I said, look at everybody's face. Because on the last day, when you look at everyone's face again, and you're going to see physical changes taking place. I look at it as though to say, let's take cellophane paper and layers and layers and layers and layers, and each layer put a different picture on it. And in the end, we're the whole picture of all the different layers. But as we clear the layers off, the picture's changing because the layers on us are changing. So what takes place is when we get metamorphosis taking place, you've actually got something that's come through and it is affecting the whole fractal of the whole hologram. And the hologram, when this thing, whatever's in there, takes place, it actually morphs into the vehicle, and that's what you're getting. How it takes place, I guess it's like saying, you look at some of the people who've taken away some of the blocks and can manifest realities. You look at people like, you know, Chris Angel and Dynamo, what they're doing. They're creating their own reality, and they're changing the molecular structure of glass and other objects because they know they can. They've taken away the limitations. And this is the same. When you've got something in a physical vehicle, it at times, at certain times, could morph through. We have had many different things on the table morphing through at times. And some of the things, it's mind-blowing when you start to see it because it's something you've never experienced or never been taught before. But the point is, when it does come through, you're looking at something that is in the field of the being that we're taking out, and it may come through in that short period of time and manifest in its true form.
I know this to be true so well, Steve. Back in 2001, I was in a particularly stressful situation. It was violent, and I had some entity that was like, I'll do it, I'll take care of stuff. And I was like, fine, you do it. And I had something inside of me, and I knew I'd agreed to it. I wasn't consciously aware of it until it was gone. And once it was gone, I mean, I literally took on a totally different, I looked completely different. That night I had gotten acne all over my face, and I was puffy. I didn't look like me at all. And it was just bizarre to see pictures of myself from that time period. And then once it was gone, it's like everything lifted. My physical features like returned back to quote unquote normal. And my total being changed completely. It was a healing that happened in the dream time, funny enough. And I had the full experience of it. I won't go into the gory details, but it was a trip to say the least. But that next morning, it was like, you know, I got out a pen and paper and I started making a list of everything I'm grateful for, you know. It was like my whole attitude, my whole being changed overnight.
I had a really good case, which was a tremendous example of this. And this man had seen, he'd seen well over 20 psychiatrists, psychologists, counselors, and he came to me and he said, they all freak out. And I said, why is that? He said, something happens. I said, okay, so what's going on? He said, look at this. And he shows his arms out, and his elbows, inside his elbows, he's got stitches. He says, both my arms, he said, were snapped backwards and broken by an invisible force. Wow. Three ribs were broken by an invisible force.
Wow.
Another time this thing jumped into my girlfriend, ripped hunks of hair out of my head, clawed me. It's huge. And every now and then it takes over and I've got no control. Okay. Get on the table. When did it start? 9 years ago, I went to a party and I got drunk. I woke up the next morning, there's a guy on my chest belting the living daylights out of me and accusing me of stealing. I had no idea what he was talking about, but I've never been so petrified in my entire life. From that day, this thing would surface. It was huge. It picked me up and threw me down flights of stairs. It threw me across the room. He said, I want to get rid of it. Get on the table, and I called it up. Next minute, he physically starts to shapeshift. His mouth extends out. He's yawning these long, thin yawns. And he's belching. It's something like 20 times my size belching away on the table. I thought, what in the hell have I got here? Spirit, how far back in time does this take place? And instantly speaking out of him, it said, 1,500 years ago. Thank you. Go there. What happened? I'm a hunter. Thank you. And what happened? I hunted down a bear. Thank you. And what happened? I got close to the bear. I thought it was dead. It was still alive. It turned on me. Bit off my right arm. Bit off my left arm. Clawed me to death. Now, he and the bear had both died in an integrated universe of fear, which has been asleep for 1,500 years. 9 years ago, and he'd never been so petrified, that triggered off that dimension. The dimension is no longer asleep. It's now active in present day, and the bear's there now, and that dimension wants out, throwing him around the room. I had to bring the spirit of the bear through, send him back 1,500 years, change the past and present and future, loop time, put him outside time, then send the man back in time, change what he did. Then I bring the bear through again. He read to move on, yes, and I release the spirit of the bear. The guy gets off the table and says, my God, it makes so much sense. I've had nightmares for years about being attacked by a bear. But that's not all. Look at this. And he took his shirt off. His chest, his back, his backside were covered in hairs 2 inches long. The thing was morphing through into him. Wow. As it was part of his field. Now, that throws Darwin theory straight out the window.
Yeah, it sure does.
All Darwin's doing is he's just looking at the genetic line. It's not taking what comes into the vehicle that can actually morph into the vehicle.
Hmm. Now, is it absolutely necessary to go back in time like that? Because, like, for instance, my personal situation, could it be that that connection with that being or entity or whatnot was a connection that I had through time, through past lives, and, you know?
Well, wherever it came from, there had to be an agreement of entrapment for it to be in your field.
Hmm.
And only by going back and looking at the cause effect of the agreement of entrapment and looping time up on that dimension can we then bring him forwards and take him out of the dimension and close off the wormhole of that dimension. But, I'll say but, if one is sheer determinism, in other words, your determinism is, I've had enough, I don't want this anymore, then that sheer determinism can make changes to those dimensions.
Mm-hmm. I think that's how I got rid of an entity that was in me. And it was the same way, Elizabeth. It was through the, it wasn't a dream state. It was like the astral state where your physical body is asleep and paralyzed, but you're fully awake in
yes.
the room.
Yes.
Yeah. It was like that.
Yeah. Me too.
And I had been, like you're saying, Steve, pure determinism. This was back in 2010. And I just started getting the sense that I had an entity. And I was like, I don't want this thing in me. You need to leave. And I just started telling it. It took about 2 weeks. I was like, you need to leave. You need to leave. And one night I woke up in the middle of the night, and it was this full-on internal battle going on where I could feel
That's
this
correct.
Thing. That's correct. And then out of my mouth was growling and hissing sounds.
That sounds so familiar.
Super
yes.
And then my astral body was thrown out of my body onto the floor. And there was all this hissing and growling from underneath my bed, and my body was getting sucked under, like towards the bed. And I was just still remaining steadfast, like, get out, get out, get out. And then it just popped out of my chest into my arms, and it was this little, like a demon-like looking dog, like an Anubis, like a little mini one. And as soon as it popped out of my chest and into my arms, I felt this overwhelming sense of unconditional love and gratitude for it. And then it like squealed and like jumped out of my arms and ran under the bed. And then I was slammed back into my bed and drenched with sweat. My heart was racing. But the next day, like you're saying, I felt so different. Yeah. And then my body did like a flush, like my whole, after that, like my body, the whatever toxins were associated with this entity were released. But yeah, it was incredible.
The only thing is, you know, Don't go with lots of love for them, I'll tell you now. Otherwise, you know, you're going to attract them back into your field. Mm. Remember, these things are invaders. These things need you to, one, feel sorry for them, two, invite them in. Look, sometimes, you know, we've gone back to find out where these things have come from, and 7-year-old, thank you, what's happening? I'm in the hospital having the appendix out, thank you. These things have been in the hospitals, and they jumped in when the person was under operation.
Mm.
You know, I've found that when people drown, nearly every person I've ever worked on that's drowned and been resuscitated, when they drown, their spirit steps out of their body, they are now vacant possession, and opportunists jump in. We go in, we find 3, 4, 5 other beings in there as well that have come in when the being stepped out of body and they resuscitated. Now there's other beings in there as well. You know, our world is not what we think it is. And we really have to understand the multi-dimensions of it. And then we've got to go beyond that to understand then who's running our world, who's running the men that are running our world, and how through initiation and rituals they get into their game and get subtly taken over by these beings. Because that's what our world is based on right now.
What are your thoughts on, like, you know, people talk about spirit guides and beings that are traveling with us to, I guess, observe, but also sometimes, you know, people say, I've asked my spirit guides to help me. What are your thoughts on spirit guides?
Look, I'm against anything at all outside your reality. My thing is, there's nothing your spirit cannot access for you. Why do you need something outside of your reality?
Things exactly. Outside
your reality. Yeah. Bingo.
Bingo. Thank you.
Yeah. Because, I mean these beings, I tell you, they're masters of illusion. Yeah. They'll be anything you want just to get the door open and get in.
I wanted to ask you to go back again. I apologize. I didn't ask the question. I was just trying to let it sink in and understand where you're coming from. But I think I'm feeling in frame of reference and also association of the words between the spirit and the soul, the spirit being the creative internal aspect and the soul being the external, the memory, the analytical, the male aspect. I'm used to hearing about the soul. It's almost like the two are referred to very in a confusing way. Would you mind reiterating? I know that you've done this at least twice so far in the first hour, but I really want to hone in on that and get really clear on what you mean by when you're speaking of the soul, because there's been a few references you know, that it's the masculine aspect and whatnot that lead to some confusion.
Sure. What I'm referring to that is that the human body itself has got the left-hand side of the body, which is your right-hand side of the brain. The left-hand side of the body is the feminine, and the left-hand side of your body is the feminine, the right-hand side is the masculine. The left-hand side of the feminine is the internal world. It is the artistic, it is the creative. The external is the analytical. It's a masculine. But putting that aside, regardless, that's only the physical vehicle. The internal being that is moving through time and chooses the vehicle it needs to come into to learn the lessons it's chosen in the past is the spirit that's moving through time. It is endless. It is timeless. It is evolving constantly through different forms through time. The vehicle it takes on now, before the physical vehicle becomes physical, it's got all these cells and memories in the cells. It takes on all the cellular memory from the ancestors, which is the hologram of time of the ancestors, which is now locked in the cells, which become part of the soul. All the external experiences upon the being that are captured in your cells is your soul. Now, every cell in you as part of the fractal of the hologram is reproducing itself as a fractal to create the whole hologram, which is you. In amongst the fractals of the holograms reproducing themselves, they are life forms, thought forms and life forms that are part of the soul that are manipulating you, and they, as a soul, can be programmed. Man can be very easily programmed, and he takes on the programs. Now, the programs are reenacting themselves through the fractal of the hologram to affect the whole hologram. So what takes place through time, man forgets who he is as a spirit, and he allows the soul of the external experiences to now manipulate and run him.
Ah, I gotcha.
Okay. The ego now, allows the soul. You're saying that the man is the ego. That part of him allows
it.
The soul.
Man is the ego. Man makes the free will choices, but the experience of choices he makes when locked into your cells as the thought form, the life form, become part of your soul. Now the soul is going to reproduce itself for its own survival, and you're the host.
So the ego is identifying itself with the soul rather than identifying itself with the spirit.
The ego is your free will choices that you make in the physical, molecular, mortal world as a free will being.
The right here, that's the right it. Now. Okay.
But all the experiences down through time of the ancestors in your vehicle become your soul. All the experiences of the vehicle in this lifetime become your soul. But the spirit is the essence. He's the driver of the vehicle. Put it another way. You see these videos on TV of the police cars and he's chasing the criminal. The video camera, as it's recording all the events that's going on, is the soul. The driver's behind the wheel, heart pounding, stresses, he's the spirit.
And the vehicle is? The
physical body. That's it.
That's a good way of saying it.
Does the physical body reincarnate over and over again? And
no, the physical body goes to rot. The physical body, it goes back to nature and recycles itself into nature. That's just a physical vehicle.
I've heard people think that they keep reincarnating in the same body, and that
you can't retain the same body. Your body is gonna, you know, your body's gonna rot and go back into the ground, and it's gonna be recycled for other things in nature. You know, your body's only a vehicle. Now, what happens is when you come back next lifetime, you're gonna take another vehicle, and before you come back, you're gonna be choosing the parents for that vehicle that you need to learn lessons from to take that and go into that vehicle. And they'll be judged on whatever you've created through these lifetimes.
Now, what is your understanding of where the spirit originates?
Well, that's interesting. You see, now let's take one example here. Watch this. Your thought becomes a thought form. Your thought form becomes a life form. The life form learns all about you and becomes an entity. The entity wants to take over the vehicle. One day you let go of him, you've had enough, and you let go of him, he's loose out there. He's got no body, he needs a body. So the simplest place is, I'll go to the local pub. So all the people on alcohol and drugs, the defences are down, it's party time. So he's jumping in, he's at party time. One day he says, hey, I'm sick to death of jumping in now, the alcoholics and drug addicts, I want my own vehicle. And the universe says, well, that's fine. You may now come back as a spirit. And what do you want? Do you want the vehicle of a tree, an animal, human? Usually start at the lower levels and then you move through. Once you take on a vehicle in this molecular mortal world, then you evolve into a spirit.
Whoa.
You understand?
Yeah. Can you go back to being a tree for vacation if you want?
Ah, well, here. I was always fascinated. I always thought we always evolve forward. I never thought we'd ever go backwards. But then I've been on a number of occasions, the universe has shown me things and said, okay, so that throws that out. Here's an example. A woman comes to me and she says, my horse is human. She said, it knows everything I'm saying, but it's got a problem. Can we work on my horse? So I said, no problem. So we surrogate the horse into someone on the table. I call the spirit of the horse through. And the first thing the horse said was, my brother bashed me and I died. I said, beg your pardon. My brother bashed me and I died. I said, hang on. Am I talking to the spirit of a horse? I said, yes. Are you telling me you were human before you were a horse? I said, yes. Why'd you come back as a horse? Because they're big and strong and no one will bash me. Well, that made sense to me. you understand?
Yes.
We have choices. We have choices.
So I'm going to say something and correct me if I'm misunderstanding. So there is just one spirit. I'm confused. So say my spirit, is it sent out and can incarnate in many different vessels or vehicles here? Or
like at the same time?
Yeah.
No. Your spirit is in your vehicle. Your spirit is a collective. I look at it and I say in the molecular mortal world we live in today, the nucleus of the atom is a spirit. The electron captured around the atom is the soul as a collective. like attracts like. Those atoms come together to create a molecular mortal vehicle, which now comes together to create you as part of the hologram, but they're all part of the fractals of the hologram. You're the hologram. Now, but your spirit is not linked to this dimension. It's linked to internal hyperspace. Therefore, it is omnipotent, omnipresent, and omniscient. What does that mean? It means it can be anywhere at any time at the same time, everywhere. In other words, we've got people in America that we are surrogating in through a couple of my students here and doing work on, then sending them back, and we're getting massive results in the changes that we're getting. Mm. Because the spirit is not governed by time nor space.
Mm. Now, the soul is that correct? Am I understanding that correctly? The soul can...
Soul is governed into the vehicle of experiences, that vehicle, that's it.
Okay,
the soul is that vehicle. It's the experiences taking on, it's the program. Okay. The soul can be programmed. It can be manipulated. It can be programmed. It can have, you know, the military can program a soul.
So there's not really an occasion where there could be another being incarnate in the third dimensional reality that is also me at the same time.
If you stop and you have a look at the cycles, can you draw a spring in your air? Draw a spring. And as you see the spring moving through time, just take the middle part of the spring. There was a past, deja vu. There is a future we're heading into. But we're in the central point, at the nodal point of the spring. As we move into the future, we'll move into the new future, and therefore the present will now become the past, the deja vu, and we'll head into another new future, that cycle of time. Now, what happens is you can short circuit through time. In other words, you can loop time. And when you loop time, you create a wormhole back in time to where things have already occurred. You know, in the early days, I used to have students in some of my research that we would send back into the past parallel future. And they would predict things for the next 2 weeks and everything spot on. I believe DARPA programs doing that nowadays.
So in terms of time, the past isn't necessarily in the past. It can be... I mean, the future can be the past can be the future in terms of how it's accessed.
Okay. Again, everything's happening now has happened before. If I short circuit through a wormhole of time to the past parallel, and I move past on that dimension, and I'm going to see the future before it occurs. Now, I've seen what's already taken place in the past parallel. I know it's going to take place in this parallel. And the past and the present will set up what's going to happen in the future parallel. If I see an event taking place in the past parallel, where it's already occurred, and I change circumstances in this dimension, then I will change the outcome of the event that took place within this dimension. You understand?
And so that it has a new future, then you can
That's correct. And that's why when we go back and look at something with a client, we're going back to its junction on the time track. We're now looping time completed, and now we're creating a new time track outside time, new time track for the future. What was is no longer, and the new time track is what is.
Now, this is happening on a universal scale right now, correct, where we're approaching this loop?
That's correct.
Now, where is this time loop generated from? Like, is this just like a pulse that the universe sends out and it's on a cycle that we're riding?
Well, it's bigger than just the universe. This is a cycle. This is a dimension. This is a dimension. Everything created is its own dimension of time. But this is a big dimension where there's nothing new under the sun. Everything's happening now has happened before with the variables. So what's happening today is a reflection of the cycle repeating itself of what's happened in the past. What will happen in the future will be the cycle of the past and present changing that future. One of the interesting things is I've been 40-odd years and I've worked on, you know, possibly well over 100,000 clients in that period of time and people, apart from training 600 students. And it's the experiences of the dimensions of people that we've worked on that's shown how the universe really works. And I've found that there is no two things the same. Like today, under our mental health system, they create this little box and they put everybody in these little boxes. Well, I've never found two cases the same. every single case has its variables and is independent and individual in its own dimension of time.
So when people say that the only way you can be attacked is if you believe you can be attacked, do you think that that's true?
No, it's not. Listen, I rarely get attacked, but I got attacked a couple of months ago. Now, this is really interesting because this took me to another level of understanding what's going on. I had a client come to me who attempted suicide. He sliced both his wrists. His mother brought him along. He's 26, mother brought him along. He's in my room. I walked in to work on the guy. As I walked in to work on the guy, bang, whoa, that's a big boy. I walked outside, drink of water, walked back in, bang, I hit again, walked back out, drink of water, say, okay, what's going on? And my spirit said he made an agreement with the entity. He didn't make an agreement to be cleared. You've got to enter the entity's game to get to him. Thank you. Now, my room is my room. You come into my room, you get dealt with. You come in the front door, you made an agreement. And if you don't get taken out, don't even come into the boundary of my property. This has all been set into play already. So now I'm aware of what's taking place. I step into its game. I now lock on the guy's eyes. I go in, get the agreement, and I take out the entity. That's how subtle it was. He had made the agreement with the entity. He did not make the agreement to be cleared. I had to enter the entity's game. Now, in other words, he who enters the game of another subject laws the game. And the moment I entered his game, it tried hitting me, but it was already in my game anyway. The moment it came into my room, it's entered the game, it's going to get taken out because they're the laws that have been set into place.
Yeah.
Understand?
Totally.
Now, are you talking about aliens? And I know you work with alien abduction. I'd like to talk a little bit about that. I'd like to talk about the alien races and how they're feeding off of us and how that works in your holographic kinetic model, the reptiles and the grays and the various ones that are interdimensionally vampirizing us.
Yeah, okay, well, the first thing we've got to do is get the category right. What I mean by that is, and I do this with my students at times, and I hear my students say, you know, they call living entities. Whoa, stop. A spirit is a spirit, and it's not an entity. If you address a spirit as an entity, I tell you, you're not going to make changes to it. If you address an entity as a spirit, you're not going to make changes to it. You've got to know what you're dealing with. So a spirit is a spirit. An animal spirit is an animal spirit. An entity is an entity. Now we're coming to the big boys. You've got the draconians. You've got the aliens. You've got the gargoyles. You've got the winged serpents. You've got a whole range of other beings out there, and there's a hierarchy structure of these beings. Now, many a time I have these things, many a time I've had them sitting up, shape-shifting, hissing, spitting out of bodies on the table at me. I've had tongues come out of humans, and I'm not kidding, come out 6 inches, moving around like a bloody lizard. Nothing surprised me anymore with some of the things I've seen over the years on the table. Now, to do that, it's understand that the big boys have been around for thousands of years, millions of years, really. This was their dimension. This was their world. But what took place, a collision took place a long time ago, and a lot of the beings, a lot of the reptilian beings were wiped off the planet. This is why all the dinosaurs, the way everything was wiped off in the collision. A lot of the beings were off planet aboard UFOs, waiting and watching as the world went through its turmoil. I have had 17 to 18 people that were left behind, and they were still stuck in the trauma of this thing coming in the world about to have a collision. They died with the trauma online, still online today, till we went in, we changed the trauma. But each one of them might say, look down to your hands and feet and describe what you see. Oh, my God. Web fingers, web toes, reptilian appearance. These were reptilian, but this was their world. But when it got knocked out of orbit, it settled in a new time-space location. Now the genetic engineering of the new human species took place. While the genetic engineering took place of the human species, many other beings came down here to look at the change, to look at the new dimension molecular world. In amongst that, for thousands of years, these beings realized the only way they could invade a human body is for initiations and rituals. So way back in time, they would set up prayer in the form of rituals, which would open the door to these dimensions. You got to go back in time. The other thing that these beings realize, and this is going on today still, and that is that if they can traumatize a spirit, then once that spirit's traumatized, that gives them access to the soul. So what's taking place if you go back through time? At the end of the last cycle, you've got the Aztecs, you know, the beans out there. You know, up to 30,000 people had their hearts ripped out. That's trauma of the spirit. What's that mean? It means they've trapped the soul in the future cycles of time. Let's go to the Inquisition. They're going to kill you anyway. Why do they torture before they kill you? To get you to submit. That gives them access to you in the future. Let's go to the secret societies. You go in the secret societies and you call these beings in for initiations, rituals, and as you work your way up, the firstborn son is allocated to these beings. What's that mean? It means as a spirit enters the vehicle at the moment of conception, a draconian enters. Thank you. What happens then? Draconian has to traumatize the spirit. So it sets up some form of trauma for the spirit. Once it does that, it keeps it traumatized. Might be violent parents they keep it into, keep it traumatized. So the spirit stays traumatized and they can take over the soul of the vehicle, manipulate the soul of the vehicle. Then they're put into positions and be manipulated because they've been programmed. Our world is not what we think it is. You've got to understand how to make changes to these dimensions, because anything that violates the human space, the human being, is violating law. And anything that violates law can be dealt with. These people at high levels in secret societies, they, through rituals, occultism, which is a dark side, they enter the game of another. He who enters the game of another is subject to laws of the game. So what's that tell me? These beings that some of these rituals can manifest and shapeshift, all right, and these guys are going to be packing it because they are now in their game. You've got to know how to control the game. You've got to know how to bring them into your game, and you control them in your game once you understand how to apply these laws.
In my conversations before with you, you had mentioned that at this time, you're seeing that there is a positive timeline, or you could call it an ascension timeline, where those people who are going to be able to maintain this zero point will be moving to a different sphere. But you're also seeing that it's the final battle for these races, the reptiles and other ones, to harvest as many souls as they can, because there to be an increase in terror and violence. And we're seeing a huge increase in negativity, and it's quite confusing for people.
This is the time of the harvest. They need to traumatize as many people as they can to get access to the soul, to recycle the soul of the being back through time into the new future cycle of time. Now, one of the things that really I feel that is a major factor that's going to take place here, and that is the proton accelerator. They're turned off, they're turned on this year at 14 trillion electron volts. Well, that tells me universal mass I look at here, one to the square, and a trillion is four lots of zeros. I believe they're going to try and hyper-jump the planet back through time.
Whoa. Whoa. What does that mean?
The whole universe is based on mass and geometry. And you're going to see in the mass and geometry to it. Example of that is let's take the number sequence of one to the zero. One is a singular. Now, as a singular, it's the law of intent. What's the intent of your spirit? But when your spirit and you, the two of you come together, that's the law of duality. And when the two of you come together, that creates the law of agreement. That creates the three. Now, the most powerful thing in the world is the tongue, because the moment we speak it, that comes into the four. That's the first form of matter. Now, to understand that at this stage, let's take two triangles together, and you've got a pyramid. Let's take the capstone of the pyramid and drew three cycles exactly over the pyramid down to the base. And what you've got is when you put the Fibonacci mathematics over that, you've got the 0, the 1, the 2, through the sequence. It finishes exactly 144 at the end of three cycles. Each cycle is a past, a present, and a future. So therefore, as you move over the triangular structure of a past, a present, and a future, it goes cause, action, reaction, effect. Now, that is the thought form, the life form, the entity. What it does at the base of the pyramid is a square. It moves from the square into the cube. From the square to the cube, we now move into platonic geometry. Through platonic geometry, we now move the tetrahedron, icosahedron, dodecahedron, octahedron. Consciousness is linked to the dodecahedron. So therefore, it's now crystallized the physical world of reality into the cells of the being. There's from the invisible world, the base is square, to the visible world of reality through platonic geometry. Now, if you go back and you look at religion, I don't like religion because of what's done to our culture. But in amongst religion, I find keys to the universe that very few people have understood. And then it says, after 144,000 years, the Nephilim uprised. Well, what's it telling me? It's saying, after 1 to the square to the cube, and at the end of the three dimensions of time, a conjunction took place and the giants went back to where they came. In Revelation saying, the key to souls have been saved 144,000. What's it telling me? After 1 to the square to the cube, at the end of the three dimensions of time, a conjunction will take place. August this year, conjunction.
That always stood out to me as when I was a kid, that 144,000. I always wanted to know what that was. What did that mean?
And that's what I'm saying. See, when you take your two pyramids, and I'm not going to give you the keys to how it works or what we're actually doing there, but we're using maths and geometry in what we're doing. We're using universal maths. But when we do, you take the pyramidal structure and you take Fibonacci mathematics, exactly three cycles of time, comes exactly 144 at the base. One to the square is the base of the pyramid, now drops into the cube, platonic geometry. Now crystallizes into cells. So it's gone from the invisible world to the visible world. So that's the structure of the visible world here. We'll continue on the numbers. So after the four, it goes to five. Let's draw the square and put a roof on. Interesting. The interesting how you draw houses with a square with a little roof on it. But what you've done is you've got the square as the first form of matter, and you've called something in from another dimension. There's a roof on your house. There's your pentagram in other dimensions. What's it do? It creates a six. What's six? Six means it now entraps itself into you. Thank you. What happens then? It changes you. Seven represents the change. What's it do then? It sets itself up in you. Eight, infinity, repeating over and over. There's your prison stuck in time. Thank you. Nine releases it, creates 360 degrees, completion of that dimension, and you're now ready to clear another dimension of reality.
It's so interesting that you just say that, because on the 9th of August, I am flying with my family. We're starting a whole new life in New Zealand, and that's the day we fly out, which is interesting. So going back to the hyper-jumping the planet, how is if we come to zero point, and how do we even know that we're zeroing in on zero point? But if a person comes to zero point, do they escape, I suppose, is a word that you can use there, that hyperjump, or what?
I really don't know. I'm only hoping there's intervention before that time to take out one of the accelerators. Because to me, I've been watching over the years how they've been setting up, and the aim was, because everything has to be known. So they put it out, they let you know, because everything has to be known. They can't do it because it violates law if they don't let it be known. So they let them know they're turned off, and they turn on 14 trillion. Well, 14 is one to the square. And a trillion is three lots of four lots of zeros. So that tells me they're going to actually try and hyperjump the planet through time. Now, every time they turn that proton accelerator, you're going to need to have a look. Go in wormhole over China, wormhole over Sydney, wormhole over Thailand, wormhole over Norway, wormhole over Russia. Every time they turn on, it creates a physical wormhole in the ionosphere.
Is that the spirals that you see in the sky?
That's it.
And that's a wormhole.
That's a wormhole through time, yes.
Because it seems like it's coming from, generated from the Earth.
Every time they turn on the proton accelerator, that's what takes place. They're trying to create the God particle. They're trying to create God. They're trying to be God.
Do you feel that the Earth has the power to override that, and that she herself is coming into her own and making a correction, and in her power will subvert that or offset that in some ways,
or even us awakening to our spirit? I mean, you know, does that have any effect on what they're doing?
Yes, she's a living entity. I'll tell you now, she's living, she's alive, she's a spirit. You know, you can communicate to her. One of the things we found is really interesting, because I went to where I wanted to go, but I mean, I wanted to find out something amazing that was going on in our world. And I didn't want to invade the game. So I'm saying, how can I do this? And my spirit said, easy. He said, call in the ancient forest. So I actually surrogate the ancient forest into one of the students. And my God, I've never heard anything so brilliant in my entire life. These old trees, 600-year-old trees, they're aware of everything that's going on now, Earth. And what they said was, we pick up everything through the leaves, pass them down the stems, for we are the consciousness of the Earth. So all of nature's communication with each other on another level. And it's aware of everything's taking place. So every time we're aware of something and we spot a violation of law, I have found every time I spot something that's a violation of law, laws of law, I spot it, I see it, I say, Spirit, deal with it. And I let go of it and it gets dealt with. There's another consciousness out there and it just needs to be aware at times of what's going on. And when you make it aware, yes, it has the ability to make changes.
So that's Mother really Earth, important. Yeah, so Mother Earth, I mean, this is her body. So
that's it.
If she's like, hey, no, you're not hyper jumping me back in time, she could do that.
But at the same time, one of the things you look at it and say, okay, look at the human body, because look, everything is the same. As a fractal of a hologram, everything is really a hologram. Everything is the same through life. So what does your body do if your body starts to take on too many toxins and too many external forces that are influencing it? What's it going to do?
Have a healing crisis, detox.
That's correct. That's correct. It's going to put you in a massive healing crisis to try and repair itself. Well, I'll tell you now, this earth, it's alive, and it's going to put itself in a massive healing crisis to repair itself. I mean, you go and look at some of the things they've done. You go over to Nigeria and have a look at the rivers there that have just all been pumped out into these rivers that used to be their life force. There's no food in the rivers anymore, so they've turned to piracy and kidnapping for their survival. You go over to Indonesia and look at some of the rivers there. These used to be rivers. They're like garbage dumps with boats driving through them. You cannot see any bit of water on them. They're just total garbage dumps. You know, you go into areas and look at what they're doing, the fracking of the oil and the gas and how that's affecting. You can't keep misusing and not recognizing, acknowledging the spirit of this earth without repercussions. And remember, all of you people out there that have taken part in anything that's harmed another, you will be back here to experience your own creation. And eventually down through time, you're going to learn, because that's what this universe is all about.
That is why we're here, to learn and grow.
That's it.
Yeah.
Wow. This has been such an amazing conversation.
We're coming to, yeah, it really, really is. We'll have to have you back. There's so much to understand the world in a completely different way than most of us have ever understood it. It's so important to remember that we can tune in to this, the power of our spirit, and ask it to do whatever it needs to do, and we can bring these forces out of ourselves that don't belong in ourselves. We have the power to change all of this. So I just wanted to bring that point again, because we're going to come to the close here very shortly, Steve. And also, we would like very much for you to give out your information, let people know how they can reach you, your website, but also your trainings, how they can work with you, how they can get sessions with you, how they can learn these techniques through you.
Well, the thing is, you got a website, www.holographickinetics.net. You'll see under future seminars where we'll be around the world. I'm actually in San Francisco. I head down next week. I'll be teaching early May in San Francisco. We'll be teaching there for 7 days. And I just come back from London recently, teaching in London. I will be up in Europe teaching. I'm in Canada teaching in July, and then off to New Zealand, August, it looks like New Zealand. Hawaii, possibly December. But to me, look, without the old ancient knowledge of the past, and I always give credit to the fact that, you know, I come from a culture, and the ancestors of my own culture, they very powerful. A lot of those spirits are still around today, assisting on another level. But the knowledge they knew about this universe, they lived 60,000 years in line with this universe. They went out hunting. They didn't take a bag of groceries with them. They didn't take water. They didn't take anything. Nature would give them the keys to everything. When the food they wanted, it was there. Water, it was there. They survived. They knew everything because they worked in line with nature. And this is where man has got so far away from these universal laws and nature that, you know, it gets this habit of thinking he knows it all. And sometimes he needs to be brought back into place in a big way. And this is what will take place with the universe. It will shake him up good and proper so as he becomes aware. Only when we start to work and align ourselves with this universe and nature will we really start to understand it, and it will work with us when we work with it. And believe me, it's very powerful. You know, we as spirits are very powerful. That's why I look at the Aboriginal culture and say, okay, why did they do stolen generation? They took away the children because it traumatizes the child, it traumatizes the parents, it traumatizes the family, it traumatizes the community. I look at the problems in communities today. They've got 93% abuse going on. We've got 80-odd% Aborigines in the prison system here. I look at this and look at the traumas passed down through time because nobody is healing the spirit. And yet millions and millions and millions of dollars went into Royal Commissions, Deaths in Custody Report, the Rights Indigenous Australia, Right to Mental Health, Human Rights. And in all the inquiries, the elders stated, in every inquiry, we need to heal the spirit. And the comment is, we're giving you spiritual in the form of religion. What more do you want? Rubbish. We need to heal the spirit. Not just the spirit of the individual, but also the spirit of the land, also the spirit of the trees. Wherever there's been trauma, we can fold time and space. We're dealing with genocide of the past. We're bringing spirits through, having them talking out of someone on the table. We're looking at what took place in the genocide. We're clearing the trauma of the genocide. We're looping time. We're changing the future. COVID never happened. Right now, we're in 26 countries because out there, nearly every country in this world has had trauma in it. And we need to clear those countries as well for the future cycles of time, because this will be part of the new future.
Yeah.
So we got to get this all done by August. We got a lot of work to do.
My thing is, listen, believe me, the last year and a half, I have not stopped. I mean, I'm doing at least 20 hours a day at times.
Wow.
I hardly sleep at all because I'm going. And about 6 months ago, I said, Spirit, this is ridiculous. I need a break. So I fell down the stairs and broke my foot.
Oh. That's what you said, the most powerful.
You've got to laugh, you know, because, yeah. I mean, at least it's got to treat things as a joke. Just keep going. We've got to keep going.
Yeah. I'm glad you got a break, Steve.
I didn't have a break. I was doing what I'm doing, you see. One of the things with people is, hey, don't panic about anything. Where you're meant to be, you're meant to be. Mm. You can't change what's going to take place in time. And the greatest thing is that whenever a person has fear online, they will attract the things they fear most in life. My thing is to understand that your spirit will have you in the right place at the right time where you're meant to be. As simple as that. Just have faith in your spirit.
There are no mistakes. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Steve.
Yes.
Blessings to you and the incredible work that you're doing. Would you give us that website one more time, please?
www.holographickinetics.net. And in that, go to future seminars, and you'll see seminars. You can contact me on the website, holographickinetics@bigpond.com. And as I said, we're doing San Francisco beginning of May. We'll be there to teach. So if anybody's interested, get on to us and, come along. You'll be fascinated. You'll be fascinated what you see. It'll take you to a whole new dimension of reality.
Thank you so much for the work you're doing. And I'm looking forward to meeting you one day.
Looking forward to meeting you all too, somewhere along the line.
Yeah.
So have we come up somewhere.
That'd be awesome.
Yes, absolutely. Me too. All right. Good night, everyone. Take care.
Good night. Thanks for listening.
Good night.
And good night to you all. Thank you.
Well, I see this is my window. Your questions. So much time is made up with answers. Doing my feet well, always on the ground. Need to be the one, beat on yourself, see it in your mind. This is all a game, do it all.
John.